why one doesn't see them occurring, Arjuna has a question. Then Krishna speaks this verse number 10. That one doesn't see them occurring because one doesn't have knowledge. Jnana chakshusa. One whose eyes are trained in knowledge can see the transmigration taking place. So the one who has Gyan Chakshu, he can see all these things. But those who are covered by mode of passion ignorance, they can't see how this transmigration is taking place, or it's so obvious. The example is Krishna has given Bhagavad Gita of Dehino Asman Yatha Dehe Kaumaram Yauvanam Jara Tatha Dehandra Prapti Dhira Satrana Muyati. This is such a simple example which everybody knows practically speaking. Didn't we observe before coming to Krishna consciousness that we had a childhood body, then we had a youth body? But despite observing all these things, did it ever came in our mind that I have to be different from this body? Why does such a thought come only when we come in Krishna consciousness? Why? Because our eyes are not trained in knowledge. So that's why there are different types of eyes. Normally we see from the eyes made of flesh and bones. That is called charma chakshu. And ultimate eyes which we want to have is prema chakshu. Premanjana churita bhakti virochanena. By eyes of knowledge we can see Krishna. But till we have developed a love for Krishna, we have to develop a knowledge, an eye in between, which is called jnana chakshu, eyes of knowledge. So between charma chakshu and prema chakshu, there is jnana chakshu. Because we see things according to our conception. According to our own conception, we see something as pleasurable, something as disgusting. Now for an elderly man, maybe drinking Coca-Cola is something very pleasurable. If you give it to a child, or somebody who's not habituated to drink it, it is a great suffering. So it depends on conception. So these things are very relative. But when our eyes are trained in knowledge, our conceptions change. And because conceptions change, that's why we see things in a different way. So that's why eyes have to be trained in knowledge. So what I'll do, I'll quickly cover verses, then I'll take the questions together. Actually speaking, I'm supposed to cover this whole chapter today. So then, Krishna says, Arjuna has a question, can anything be done about it? People are not trained in knowledge, they are suffering like anything, moving from one body to another body. Can something be done about that? So Krishna answers in text number 11. Yatanto yugunas chenam pasyanti atmani avasthitam yatanto api Akatatmano nenam pasyanti achetasa. Please read.
The endeavoring transcendentalists who are situated in self-realization can see all this clearly. But those whose minds are not developed and who are not situated in self-realization cannot see what is taking place, though they may try to.
So Krishna says, I can give them knowledge by which they can philosophically see by developing Gyan Chakshu. That's why those who are endeavoring transcendentalists who have got this Gyan Chakshu. So we all are come in the category of endeavoring transcendentalists. Basically, it's called sadhaka. We all are sadhakas. And if we develop this knowledge, to that degree, we can philosophically see the things. That's called seeing from a Gyan Chakshu, philosophical basis. So we can see clearly. But those whose minds are not developed, who are not situated in self-realization, even though they try, they can't see. So there are many people who try to philosophize the problems of this world. And they come up with different philosophies which are totally imperfect. So you'll find even in the anywhere you go, people talk about it. They write songs about it. Now, so all the movie songs are filled with that. Especially if you talk about, Tamil movies and Telugu movies. But I would like to hear the songs of old Indian movies when I was very, before coming to Krishna consciousness. Because I would find a lot of philosophy in them. But they all were nonsense philosophies or subsidiary philosophies. They would say, Swarg bhi yahan, Narg bhi yahan, iske sawa jana kahan, heaven is also there, hell is also there. So when people suffer, suddenly question comes, why am I suffering? What to do? Hell is here only, heaven is here only. So then people have philosophy. Similarly, one of the movies came where a hero, he dies out of cancer. And then he says that now what to do? We are all like puppets in the hand of the dramatist, the Supreme Lord. And we all have to play our part. So I am playing my part, I am going away. You also have to play your part, you also have to go away. So this way people have a lot of philosophies. So actually speaking, with the time when people undergo a lot of suffering, they have to come up with some philosophy. Otherwise, they can't live. So they use their intelligence and try to find out something. But actual thing is, we can know the right philosophy through the person who has written the script. That is Krishna. So Krishna knows what is the right philosophy. So that is how people can philosophically see. Those who are endeavoring transcendentalists, others cannot see. So then Arjuna has a question. What is the cause of those with knowledge, they are able to see you, and those without knowledge not being able to see you? So then Krishna says, person without knowledge has been engaged in mental enjoyment from time immemorial. He is unable to feel the existence of his own soul within his body. He has not bothered to clean his heart by hearing and chanting. So even if he endeavors, the knowledge cannot arise in his impure heart. So because he is so much covered with passion and ignorance, one cannot see. So to the degree one has a desire to enjoy sense gratification, to the degree one has indulged in sense gratification, to that degree one cannot see all these things occurring. One cannot see the things in a right perspective. And to the degree one is detached from sense gratification, to that degree one can see rightly. Because satya sanjayate jnanam, from satya guna comes the knowledge. So then Arjuna has a question, but my Lord, you are supposed to be merciful. So is there any way in which those who are ignorant can also see you? Is there any possibility how they can also see you? Krishna says, yes, there is a way. So how one can see? Krishna speaks in from 12th. So we'll quickly read 12th and 13th. Yad aditya gatam tejo jagat bhasate akhilam yad chandra masicha yad chagnav tat tejo viddhi mamakam. Please read.
The splendor of the sun, which dissipates the darkness of this whole world, comes from me. And the splendor of the moon and the splendor of fire are also from me.
So what Krishna speaks here is, even if you want to enjoy sense gratification, you need to see sense objects. How do you see the sense objects? Only because of sunlight and moonlight. So the petroleum is also a stored sunlight only. It's not different. So we are dependent on sun and moon to see sense objects which we may enjoy. In this way, we are also dependent on Krishna for even sense gratification. So Krishna gives this example. So they should understand that even for sense gratification, they are dependent on me. So in this way, on a global scale also, everybody is dependent on Krishna. Now 13th one. Gama vesecha bhutani dharayami aham ojasa. Pushnami, Chosadhi, Sarva, Somo, Bhutva, Dasatmaka. Please read.
I enter into each planet and by my energy they stay in orbit. I become the moon and thereby supply the juice of life to all vegetables. Hare Krishna.
So Krishna says that it is because of me, because of which the sun, moon, all these planets are floating. They are moving. Similarly, it is because of me only that all the vegetables are getting juices. Pushnami cha osadhi. And they are getting rasatmaka. They are getting rasa. So I am the moon which gives nourishment to the vegetables, which is, I was talking about prana, how it comes. And it is because of moonlight that there is some taste in that. So as sun and moon, I am doing all these things. I am doing for everyone. So by that they can remember me at least. And now, there's so many people they pray, na? Thank you God for our air, water, moon. In the Christian school, they have prayers like that. So at least we are, so they say at least for sense gratification, we are dependent on the Lord. So that may be very gross vision, but at least something they are recognizing the presence of the Lord. And then personally also we are dependent on the Lord for our sense gratification. How? Text number 14. Aham vaishma naro bhutva prani naam deham asrita prana pana samayukta pachami annam chaturvidham. Please read.
I am the fire of digestion in the bodies of all living entities, and I join with the air of life, outgoing and incoming, to digest the four kinds of foodstuff. Hare Krishna.
So because of Lord, we can enjoy even the pleasure of eating. This is one of the most relishable pleasures for all the people in the world. And that's why ISKCON's prasadam programs, distribution programs are most famous. So people many times have philosophical problems with ISKCON, but they don't have problem with prasadam and the type of music which we have. Hare Krishna Mahamantra. But even for enjoying the pleasure of the tongue, one is dependent on the Lord. And when this fire of digestion within the belly, it combines with the life airs, the 10 type of airs are there, then we can digest our food. So there are four types of food which are mentioned. Bhaksha, bhojya, leha, chosya. So these four types of food are digested because of the mercy of the Lord. So what are they? Bhakcha means those who are chewed, bhoja means sipped, leha means which are licked, and chosya means they are sucked. So they all help in digestion. So when this fire of digestion combines with saman vayu, so then one can digest all the food. And the saman vayu is located on the region of solar plexus, navi. So that's why yogis, they always keep the navi on the right position so that they can digest things properly. And if food is digested properly, there's no malfunction in the body. So this is how yogis remain very healthy and they can live for many, many years. So Lord says, for that also you're dependent on me only. If there's no fire of digestion, you can eat, but you cannot digest. And once we cannot digest, we won't like to eat anything else. So that is how we're dependent. And this is generally for ignorant beings who try to enjoy this world. But for those who are transcendentalists, they are also dependent on me. How they are dependent on me? That Krishna explains in 15th verse. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannavishto matta smitir jnanam apohanam cha vedesya sarvir aham eva vedyo vedant vede ved eva chaham. Please read.
I am seated in everyone's heart, and from me come remembrance, knowledge, and gratefulness. By all the Vedas, I am to be known. Indeed, I am the compiler of Vedanta, and I am the knower of the Vedas. Hare Krishna.
So Krishna says, Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivishto. I am seated in everyone's heart. Mritta smitir, matta smitir, jnanam apohanam cha. So because of me only, the remembrance comes, forgetfulness comes. forgetful of your real identity so that you can enjoy this world. So remembrance comes from me, forgetfulness comes from me, knowledge also comes from me. Yeah. And for those who are ignorant, for them I am compiler of the Vedantas. Vedant Krit. Ved Ved Evachaham. Because I am the goal of the Vedanta. But then Arjuna has a question in mind. He says that you may say that from all the Vedas you are to be known. But many people who read Vedas and they say Shiva is to be known. Some say that Ganesh is to be known. Some say Brahman is to be known. Some say I am supposed to be known. Somebody say Amma Bhagwan is supposed to be known. Some say, you know, Sai Baba is supposed to be known. So different people have so many opinions. How do we understand that what you are saying is right? So then Krishna says, because Vedant Krit, I am the compiler of the Vedas. As Ved Vyas, I have compiled the Vedas. So because I have compiled the Vedas, I know what is the right thing. Like if you want to ask what is written in the book, best person to ask is author. Author knows why he has written a particular thing. So similarly says Vedant Krit, I am the compiler of the Vedas. That's why I know what is the essence of the Vedas. So I am telling Ved Ved that I am the knower of the Vedas because I am the compiler of the Vedas. Being author, I am the actual knower of the Vedas. Other people don't know the meaning. That's why they should take shelter of me if they want to understand the Vedas. So I am saying that I am to be known. That means I am to be known. So I am the essence of the Vedas. So then Arjuna says, so if you are the knower of the Vedas, please tell me concisely the essence of the Vedas. So Krishna tells the essence of the Vedas in next three verses, which is called Tri Shloki Shastra, and it is also called Purushottam Yoga. So 16, 17, 18, they talk about the essence of the Vedas in three verses. So 16th will take. Dvam imao purushe purusho loke charas chakchara evacha chara sarvani bhutani kutisto akchara uchate. Please read.
There are two classes of beings, the fallible and infallible. In the material world, every living entity is fallible. And in the spiritual world, every living entity is called infallible.
So mental world everybody is fallible, in spiritual world everybody is infallible, because those are perfected beings especially. And then Krishna's Prabhupada writes in the purport, those who are in oneness with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, however, is called infallible. Oneness means oneness of purpose. Who are infallible? Those who fulfill the desire of the Lord. Because desires of the Lord will be fulfilled anyway. 100% sure, guaranteed. So if you make desire of the Lord as your own desire, then one is also infallible. Because Lord is 100% guaranteed he is going to be successful. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Para Dhanodara, Tatra Sri Vijayoga Bhutir, Dhruva Nidhir Mitarumma. Whereas Krishna is there, Gandhidhari Arjuna is there, Sanjay says in the last verse. So there 100% success guaranteed. Because Krishna's desire will be fulfilled. Our desires may or may not be fulfilled. So that's why if we accept Krishna's desire and try to fulfill them, 100% success is guaranteed. So then such people become infallible because they are having oneness of purpose. Other people, they may or may not be successful. So Prabhupada writes in the last lines of the purport. But in the spiritual world, the body does not change. There is no old age, there is no birth, there is no death. They all exist in oneness. Oneness of purpose. Chara sarvani bhutani. Any living entity who had come in contact with matter beginning from first grade being Brahma, down to small end, is changing its body. Therefore, they are fallible. In the spiritual world, however, they are always lived in oneness. So infallible. Because they all try to fulfill the desire of Krishna. And desire of Krishna, how we do? We know that through Guru Sadhu Shastra. गुरु मुखा पद्मा वाक्या चितिते कोरी एक्या और ना करी हो मना आसा. So if we accept the desire of spiritual master as life and soul, then we'll also will not be fallible. Now coming in 17th. उत्तमा पुरुषस्तु अन्या परमात्मेति उदायता या लोक त्रयम् आवेश्य विभर्ति अव्यय ईश्वरः. Please read.
Besides these two, there is the greatest living personality, the supreme soul, the imperishable Lord himself, who has entered the three worlds and is maintaining them.
So above Charanakshara is also Supreme Lord. That means you never become supreme even if you are liberated. So this is very clearly mentioned here. Even in liberated state, Jiva is Jiva, Krishna is Krishna. Because above both Krishna and Jiva is Supreme Lord. Super soul is above both of them. So we'll read this last verse also, 18th.
Yasma charamati toham aksharat api chottamaha ato asmi loke vede cha pratita purushottamaha.
Please read.
Because I am transcendental, beyond both the fallible and infallible, and because I am the greatest, I am celebrated both in the world in the Vedas as that Supreme Person.
Now Krishna makes very clear here, aham, yasma charam atito ham aksharat apicha uttamaha. I am that person, I am that super soul. 17 Krishna speaks indirectly, that above both of them there is a super soul. And here Krishna makes very clear, who is that super soul? I am that super soul. That means I am below both fallible and infallible. So one who knows that I am the greatest, I am celebrated both in this world and the next world, and the Vedas who say that I am the supreme person, those who know that, they are actually knower of all the Vedas. So when you know these three verses, that they are fallible person, they are infallible person, and there is Supreme Lord above both of them, and that person is Krishna, he is the knower of all the Vedas. So this is the essence of Vedas in concise in these three verses. So that's the Supreme Person of God Krishna is. So I'm a little over time, but can we just read through two verses? We don't have to explain much. So I'll just quickly read.
यो माम एवम असमूढ़ो जानाति पुरुषोत्तमम सा सर्वविद भजति माम सर्वभावेन भारत.
प्लीज रीड.
Whoever knows me as Krishna, Godhead, without doubting, is the knower of everything. He therefore engages himself in full devotional service to me, O son of Bharata.
Anybody who knows that engages in devotional service to Krishna. And then the last verse.
इति गुहितमं शास्त्रम् इदम् उक्तं मया नगः एतद् बुद्ध्वा बुद्धिमान् स्यात् कृता कृत्यश्च भारत.
प्लीज रीड.
दिस इज द मोस्ट कॉन्फिडेंशियल पार्ट ऑफ द वैदिक स्क्रिप्चर्स ओ सिनलेस वन एंड इट इज डिस्क्लोज्ड नाउ बाय मी हूएवर अंडरस्टैंड्स दिस विल बिकम वाइज एंड हिज एंडेवर्स विल नो परफेक्शन.
Anybody who knows that Krishna is actually Janati Purushottamam, that Krishna is Purushottama. He is not Purushottama because his name is given Purushottama. In this world, many people have name Purushottam, but they are not Purushottam. Like in Hindi, there are many sayings are there. One of the saying is that Aankh ka andha naam nayan sukh. Child has the name Nayan Sukh, that he has pleasure of eyes, but he may be a blind person. So name and the form of a person don't match in this world. Similarly, there was we call it Hasya Kavita. So this said, the person was introducing someone in his village. So he was telling that, I don't exactly remember now. सुबह दूध और बाल्टा लेके जाएं शहर की ओर, रात को दारू पी के लौटे हमारे गांव के नंद किशोर. This is saying in India. I'll explain. So there's a person called Nandakishore, because Nandakishore is Krishna, and Krishna is a cowherd boy. So he's also a cowherd boy. So he goes with the milk van, and goes for selling the milk. But in the night, he comes after drinking. The name is Nandakishore, but he doesn't have work like Nandakishore. So what it means is that people have a different name and different qualities here in this world. But Krishna says, I am not meant Purushottam like that. I'm actually Purushottam. I'm actually the best among all the enjoyers. I am actually better than all the Purushas, the three Vishnus. That's why I'm called Purushottam. So I'm not a Purushottam just for namesake. I'm actual Purushottam. So one who knows that I am actual Purushottam, he's unbewildered in this world. And he is known as Sarvavit. He is the knower of everything. So although it may seem that he doesn't know certain things of the Vedas, but actually he knows. So anybody who understands this, three slokas, 16, 17, 18, three sloki sastra, he is knower of everything. He'll become my devotee and he'll be serving. He'll be expert. And Krishna says, but don't speak that to the unqualified person, this three sloki sastra. So this is the supreme secret. Iti guhe tamam. Don't speak to those who are not qualified. Only those who are my devotees, explain this secret to them. So this is how it ends. Now we'll take the questions. Tanuja Mataji is waiting for a long time. Tanuja Mataji.
Hare Krishna Pranams, Prabhuji. We know now I'm very confirmed that our goal is to reach the spiritual planet. But still, I'm curious about transmigration because of the Shraddha ceremonies we perform often. And we offer the oblations. And we say that the bird, they come in the form of birds and they accept the food. Is it real or how is it?
So really speaking, I don't know much about it. Something which I know, I'll tell you. So that detail is given in, if you can go to the second part of Laws of Nature. And also in the fifth canto, these certain details are given. So what happens at that point of time is, one subtle body is taken away. And then one gets one is presented in front of Yamraj. But on the way, person has to undergo a lot of troubles. One has to go through the hot sand, sun from the top. So then people say that, no, can I get some umbrella to protect myself? So then Yamduta say that if you have the umbrella, you have given the umbrella in charity, then you can have it. That means you didn't have charitable disposition, being especially the householder, then no, you can't get it. So then that's why if you remember, especially it's very common in South India. It happened in North India also. They give umbrella in charity. So that when you go through the hot sun, you can carry the umbrella. Then they give chappals in charity, the slippers. Because there is a hot sand. So with all those troubles through, one goes in front of Yamraj, thinking now it's okay. But then after going to Yamraj, then the judgment starts. So then people, the majority of their sins, they suffer in the hellish planets. So as far as they coming in the form of bird, etc., I didn't read anywhere. And even I didn't hear from my mother, because my mother is very expert in Purana. So from childhood, she has been teaching me the Puranic stories. So she especially would speak a lot from Garuda Puran that describes how transmigration very nicely. So I didn't hear anything like that. So I'm not sure if it is given some other Puran, because I didn't read all the Puranas. Okay.
Thank you.
So the one gets Yatana Sari. We can read all the description. That's why second part of Laws of Nature is very interesting. And it talks about transmigration. Raghunandan Gaurangpuru. Yeah.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, then what pronounce?
Yes, please.
Probably in this 15th chapter, 16th verse, It's given the word like oneness. So the three places is given oneness. Exactly what it means to be the oneness. And given also in the spiritual world, however, they are always liberated in oneness. Exactly what it means. Can you please explain, Prabhuji? And also, I see in many places, apparently in the verse, many places given Prabhupada quoted oneness. So can you please be first, Prabhuji, about the oneness?
Yeah, so I already spoke it. Oneness is oneness in purpose. Oneness in purpose. Purpose. See, very simple thing. I may have hands, legs, belly, nose, mouth, tongue, everything. Let us say they are different persons. Hand is a separate person, leg is a separate person, tongue is a separate person, belly is a separate person. But then, what is their actual purpose? What is their actual purpose? It's not a very difficult question. Yeah.
Feeding stomach.
Purpose is there.
To serve our body. Feeding stomach.
To fulfill the desire of the person who is having hands, legs, everything. That is the purpose. So similarly, oneness in purpose is there. All the people work together to fulfill the desires of Krishna in the spiritual world. So that is the purpose. Krishna says this should be done. All the living entities in the spiritual world, they cooperate together to fulfill that desire of Krishna. So that is how there's oneness in purpose. And what is that purpose? Fulfilling desires of Krishna. That's all. Is it clear now?
Thank you so much. Very, very clear, Prabhuji. Crystal clear. Hare Krishna.
Hare Bol. Madhavendra Karuna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yes, Madhavi.
Prabhuji, in this 15.18, third paragraph, it's written the super soul coming out of the body enters the impersonal Brahma Jyoti. Then in his form, he remains in his spiritual identity. That supreme is called a supreme personality. What does it mean? This mean, Prabhuji? Coming out of the body enters the impersonal Brahma Jyoti.
Yeah. So this is actually the Supreme Lord in his localized spirit of Paramatma is also describing the Vedas themselves. The following appears. The super soul coming out of the body enters the impersonal Brahma Jyoti. Then in his form, he remains in his spiritual identity. The Supreme is called Supreme Personality. So when we say Brahma Jyoti means spiritual sky. So spiritual sky. And there also he remains in his spiritual identity. He doesn't lose his identity. So whether one is getting Brahman realization or Paramatma realization or Bhagavan realization, any of the realization, one's identity is not lost, is clearly explained by Prabhupada here. And that supreme is called supreme personality means, whether you talk about Brahma Jyoti, Paramatma or Bhagavan, all three of them are actually the same thing. Because Krishna's effulgence is non-different from him. So when we say Brahma Jyoti, we say we are with Krishna. When you are with actual person, you can see Krishna, you are with Krishna. So in this way, still there are persons. So what this particular Chanda Yoga Upanishad verse is speaking here is, after the super soul coming out of the body, he enters the Brahma Jyoti. That means when one goes back home, back to Godhead, what happens to the super soul? He is a part of the eternal cosmic manifestation. That's all. He is not lost. So that's the same thing. Simple, no?
Okay, Prabhuji. Okay, Prabhuji.
So whether it is... okay. So whether it is soul or super soul, both of them, they maintain their personality. So his spiritual identity stays there. Okay.
प्रेम राज गोपीनाथ प्रभु
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु जी प्रभु जी क्वेश्चन इज रिलेटेड टू द 16 17 एंड 18 वर्सेस दैट व्हाई कृष्णा रिकमेंड्स दैट नॉट टू डिस्क्लोज दिस कॉन्फिडेंशियल नॉलेज टू अ जनरल पीपल एज दिस In, from is everybody should know that the Krishna, God is a Krishna.
So what Krishna speaks in? So there is a particular word who used here. It is 19. Idi Goitamam Sastra Mita Muktam Maya Anagaha. Anaga means Krishna says, my dear Arjuna, you are anaga means you are sinless. Na? So this is the most confidential part of the Vedic scripture of sinless one, and it is disclosed now by me. So this is supposed to be spoken to only those people who don't have envy for Krishna. So somebody is engaged in sin because he is envious of Krishna. So then Krishna says, even if you explain it to him, he'll become much more envious. So you must have observed while preaching many people that as soon as they see devotee, they become very angry. They start shouting, yelling. Some people start creating trouble also. Like now, in your own country, why don't you go and preach to the people of other religion in your country? In Sarja. Because you know that they are a little envious. So then somebody is so envious, if you just tell him, he'll become much more envious. So those who are neutral or those who are receptive, we can speak to them. Okay, that is the main purpose.
Okay, thank you very
much. Yeah, Sepro Mamta Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. I don't know if I have heard it incorrectly today or maybe I misunderstood. In the beginning of the class, we learned where the Yamadutas come and take the subtle soul and the soul goes behind them. Is that what you said, Prabhuji?
Subtle bodies. Subtle bodies.
Yeah, the subtle body and what you call the soul goes along with them.
Yeah.
What is that context which you were trying to imply? Maybe I missed that part. If you can explain that, Prabhuji.
Okay. So what I was explaining is, that it is because soul is attached to the subtle body. That's why he goes along with the subtle body.
That's during transmigration?
Even now also. You are not gross body. You are not subtle body. Why are you suffering here? So you are suffering because you are attached to this gross body and subtle body. So if one doesn't have a desire to enjoy, one will not remain with gross and subtle bodies. It's because of desire to enjoy we are having these bodies. And there is an episode which comes in the third canto of Bhagavatam, third or second canto it comes, where all the souls are lying on the body of Mahavishnu. So they don't have gross body, they don't have subtle bodies. And Mahavishnu has to keep them on sleep. But sometimes what happens is certain souls wake up. And when they wake up, they lament like anything. Because they have strong desire to enjoy, but they don't have gross or subtle body to enjoy. So what Mahavishnu does is, he again brings them to sleep. That means, why are we having subtle body or gross body? Because we want subtle and gross bodies. So as soon as that desire to enjoy is not that desire there to serve, then there's no need of subtle and gross body. So if we have fully developed our service attitude to serve Krishna, then we don't need this mental body. So we need this mental body till we have desire to enjoy. When there's only desire to serve, we don't need a mental body. And we don't need a mental body. The mental body is not given to us. Very simple.
Okay. But how was that particular soul was lamenting for it? Does it mean that soul has that chitta element? Chitta element is a part of the subtle elements.
Yeah, but soul is by nature conscious.
But conscious is a part of the four elements of the subtle.
No. Chitta is not conscious, it's a dead. How can a dead matter be conscious? So because there is no good word for chitta in the English, Prabhupada writes it as contaminant consciousness. But it has no consciousness. It's not a conscious element. It's a dead element. Mahatattva is a metal element. It's not a spiritual element. So it is soul who is conscious. So soul is conscious. At the same time, soul also has a senses. You remember I explained spiritual eyes are there, hands, legs, everything. So you can see. Okay.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Divya Dino Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Pranams, Prabhu. Pranam, Prabhuji, in the 15th, chapter 17th verse, it says that the in the spiritual world, the entities are infallible. Then, Prabhu, how that desire comes to enjoy separately from Krishna? They do not have a material body and the spiritual body will not have any desires, Prabhu. Then how should we understand?
It's not that spiritual body doesn't have a desire. No desire means dead matter. Only matter doesn't have a desire. As pure devotees, we have pure devotees have spiritual desires. And those are non-devotees, have material desires. One cannot be desireless.
And those even
those who say, I want to become desireless, they also have a desire, na? What is the desire to become desireless? It is a desire only. One cannot remain without desire. Yeah.
So that means in spiritual world also, the spiritual entities will have desire.
Yeah, that desire is there. See, when Krishna says punargatva na nivatante tad dham paramam, what actually he means is independence means love. You can love me or you can choose not to love me. That means you are loving me. If I keep a gun next to your head and say love me and you say that I love you, that means there's no love. There's only artificial thing. So love means it's a free will, it's a free choice. And that is called manual independence. So we have a desire to either enjoy with Krishna or enjoy like Krishna. So that desire is a very part of soul's existence. But what happens is when one has a desire to enjoy like Krishna, one is sent to this material world. And after coming to this material world, one has such a bitter experience. And Maya Devi, who is first class servant of Krishna, makes sure that she beats all these living entities, black and blue, to such a degree that once they haven't gone back, they don't come back again. And being very confident of his own energy, Maya, Krishna says, Yad gatvana nivartante patta dham paramam mama. After going there, nobody returns. Because here you get such beatings that you will not go back. Okay, na? So that's how. So tomorrow class, tomorrow what is the homework? Read chapter number 16 and chapter number 17. And we completed 10th group. So 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So 11 to 16 group, please be ready with your presentations and skits, whatever things are there. So that you can present in the tomorrow's class. And Ramya Radhika Mataji had a question, which I told I'll answer later on. So, but please wait. Actually, I'm talking with one devotee who's a little far off.
Okay, brother. Okay, thank you.
You're taking time to answer it. So okay. Only then. Actually, this was my question also when I read, but I forgot it. Somehow Krishna made you a medium to remind me of this question.
Hare
so I'll maybe answer it then tomorrow or next class. All that.
Okay.
Srinivas Prabhu, he still has a question.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, this is regarding to previous question which is asked by Divya Maharaj. Like, how does the soul is having some desire there? So how does the independent enjoyment from separate from Krishna? How that first desire comes actually? Because when we were in spiritual world in the association of Lord, we are all perfect, so we should not have any independent desire. How does the first desire come? Once we desire came, we came here, we are struggling here, that is okay. We go back and we will never come back again because we remember the miseries we have gone through all these lifetimes. So how does the first desire came actually?
Life means desire. And desire means independence. There is no question of being life without independence. What difference between a robot and a living being? Difference is free will. And free will means freedom to enjoy with Krishna or enjoy like Krishna. So there is no question of having love, having independence, having life without that independence. So that independence is always given to the living entity. Okay, na? See, even after going there, you have independence. But only thing is because you are carrying all these experiences of the material world, we don't go back, come back. That's Krishna's confidence. But that independence is always there. There's no question of having a life without independence. Now, Bhakti Swarup Damodar Maharaj, I remember when he would give a very powerful example to explain this concept of free will. Let us say you take a cricket ball. Keeping all the conditions very ideal, can you explain the trajectory of the cricket ball if you throw it? Srinivas Prabhu?
It goes straight to the face.
Yeah. See, main thing is, you must have read parabolic movement and all these things in class 12th. In physics, we can define its trajectory very easy. Now take a mouse, throw the mouse. Can you predict its trajectory? Why?
Because it has independence, it can go anywhere.
Yeah. So similarly, life means independence. So we can choose to be with Krishna or enjoy like Krishna. Otherwise, there is no question of life. Otherwise, we are just robots. So life means independence. Okay, does it make sense?
Bro, nice, bro.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. So we'll end here. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki Srila Prabhupada ki.